This is not, and I capitalize the word not. This is not a basic necessity. You don't need this to survive, but it sure does make life a lot easier, especially since our society is built on electricity. This is why we are so vulnerable to an EMP. And you take a third world country, and there could be an EMP over their country, and they might not even be affected at all. Whereas it could kill up to 90% of our population over a period of time. So we are inundated with electronics, with the use of electricity. That's why having your renewable energy system is so nice. And I've got to tell you, we built mansions in Georgia for people before we left 19, 20 years ago. And they were very nice homes. We couldn't afford it, but I built homes for people who could. And we like convenience, and we have convenience with our alternative energy system. So it's really nice to at least think about this. And I want to say this about, alternative energy systems. You will put the money out first for the equipment, then the payback comes over the years. Whereas when you live on the grid, like just about all of you do, and I know I'm an ex-builder, it's very inexpensive to hook up electricity to the power grid company. I built on Georgia Power for many years, your TBA up here, I guess. And it didn't cost that much for me to hook the houses up that I built. Where they get you is over the long run, that monthly bill. And you know it adds up. So when you get an alternative energy system, you put the money out up front. And if you take care of that equipment, it'll last you for years. And it's hardly, I buy one drum of off-road diesel a year. That's basically all I spend for power. And that's probably, it's about $2 a gallon. So we're talking a little, well, yeah, it's maybe, it might be up to $240 for a drum of off-road or red diesel to run my diesel generator in the wintertime only. This time of the year, we don't even think the battery to my diesel generator is dead. I have to jump start it in October when I fire it up for the first time. And we turn it off. We quit using it generally in March, and we don't even use it till October. And that means our energy is free. It's from the sun. We wash it, our LG washer operates from the sun. Now, I've got to qualify that. We do use a little propane for our dryer, but our dryer, LG dryer, uses electricity also to turn the drum and the fan in it. So anyway, renewable energy systems becoming free from dependence on utilities. And believe me, it is wonderful. And I want to tell you this also. After building homes, I started to see how our government, local governments, were starting to use electricity hookups as a way to keep up with you. You follow what I'm talking about? You've heard of smart meters, I think. Do they have smart meters up here yet?
Yes.
Are they requiring everybody to use them? Well, if you look into smart meters, you'll see what all they do with it. With them. There's just, I'm telling you, if you can be disconnected from the systems of the world as much as possible, you will start to see the fruits from that. Electricity is one. Okay, let's get started. And as we get started, let's look at a couple of simple electrical definitions. AC, or alternating current. You know, everything in here operates on alternating current. Just about everything. This is being charged by alternating current, but it operates on another kind of electricity that we're going to talk about. But alternating current, what does that mean? That means somewhere in the United States is a power plant creating electricity, sending power right to your house, right to this church through transmission lines. If that power plant went down for some reason and they didn't get the power usage transferred over to another power plant somewhere else in the country, we wouldn't have electricity. So when an AC light is running, whenever you're using alternating current, it requires a power plant somewhere creating electricity 24/7. The other kind of electricity is DC, direct current. If it wasn't for DC electricity, none of you would be sitting here.
That's because of our taxes.
That's what?
Because of our taxes, DC.
All of you have DC batteries in your cars. DC is the only electricity that I know of that you can store. You cannot store AC, but you can store DC. You have your car batteries or any kind of batteries, direct current, it stores electricity. Now, let's look at a typical emergency backup system for a home. This is a typical one. This is the kind of system the folks down in South Georgia and South Florida in a few days are going to wish they have. And that's a generator connected to a house. That's just a basic system. Now, let me give you the pros and cons of this kind of system. The pros are when you set up a system like this, the initial cost is less costly. And it's an easy hookup. That means unless you can do the work yourself, that means less of an electrician's charge to hook up. Now, the cons of this is you get power only when this generator is running. That can be very costly. It's extremely dependent on fuel. But something else that's most important, and you're going to find out in the coming days how important this is. The noise from the generator could draw unwanted attention. Just take my word for it. Okay, now, let's look at the basic theory of an alternative energy system. The basic theory. First of all, you start with a device, any device that generates electricity, AC or DC. Most of them generate AC. Then, that sends electricity, red arrow in this case, AC is generally indicates AC in our graphics. That sends electricity to the battery bank, and then the battery bank sends electricity to the house. Now, you might ask, well, why don't you just send electricity from the generator straight to the house, like the first picture. This kind of setup, where you have a battery bank, will enable you to turn the generator off once in a while, which will be peace and quiet. Now, there's a little more to it. We're going to go into it in just a second. But first of all, we want to talk about the types of batteries that we use. First of all, type of batteries you use in an alternative energy system are deep cycle batteries. The batteries in your car are shallow cycle batteries. Shallow cycle means it will cycle down to about 80% capacity. Then your regulator or whatever it is, it turns the alternator on, it'll charge it back up to 100%. Cycles up and down between 80 and 100%, roughly. That's called a shallow cycle battery. Deep cycle batteries cycle between around 20% and 100%. Go down to 20%, back up to 100%. Your marine batteries are also deep cycle. Now, it's not good to cycle down to 20% capacity, but they can make it. But if you do it too much, it's not good for them. Okay, the size of the batteries you use in an alternative energy system. And by the way, the picture you see here is a Trojan. That's the brand name, probably the most popular brand name in alternative energy systems. The size of this, or the model of it, is an L16. That's kind of a typical size of your alternative energy batteries. And you size them by the volts they produce and the amp hours that they hold. Now, don't feel you have to memorize this. I'm just scratching the surface. When I say amp hours, it's like saying this is a 5-gallon tank or a 10-gallon tank. You could say this is a 50 amp hour battery or a 100 amp hour battery. It tells you the capacity of amps that battery will hold. Batteries for alternative energy systems come anywhere from 12, 24, or 48 volt systems. 12, 24, or 48. The lifespan of these batteries, batteries are probably the weak link in an alternative energy system. These L16s, made by most, you know, the companies that make them, Trojan being one, if you take care of them, will last, I hear, 6 to 8 years. And then you have to buy them all over again. Now, I cut my teeth on 4 Trojan L16s. And when I say I cut my teeth, I was just learning. And I didn't take care of them, and mine lasted 5 or 6 years. And just before I was about to double my capacity, so I didn't have to run the generator so often, I was about to buy 8 L16s. And it was gonna cost me around $3,100. And Nick, who is really, he's so far ahead of me in knowledge of all this stuff, he said, Dad, he said, I wish you'd look into forklift batteries. Forklift batteries. There are probably millions of these across the country. There are probably thousands upon thousands of warehouses across the country. And if not tens of thousands, maybe millions of forklifts. And a lot of them operate on batteries. And they're big batteries. So I looked into it. And I compared the amp hours that I would get with 8 of the Trojan L16s with the cost of buying one forklift battery that has the same capacity, you know, the same gallons in electricity, you call it amp hours. And instead of costing me $3,100, it was gonna cost me $2,200. And these forklift batteries, they say will last up to 15 years instead of average 7 to 8 years. So why not pay a third less and get double the lifespan? So I did, and we're now on our sixth year. And the battery's doing fine. So this is something to look into. This is something that Nick really covers. He has a website. I'm gonna mention it at the end of it. I'm gonna mention it right now. He has a website like no other that I know of in the world. He teaches you how to design your own system. Instead of calling up an alternative energy company and telling them, I've gotta have a double wide refrigerator, I would die without this. When you do that, they're gonna run the price up to cover the electricity for all the convenience you want to run. He teaches you in this course what, if you do without this, it'll cost you less, or he'll show you, the less you have to use, the less your system is going to cost up front. When you design your own system, and that's also taking into account the shade, how much trees you might have to cut down, how many trees. You might not have to cut down any. He shows you how to analyze that. His website is Off-Grid Bootcamp, O-F-F Grid, G-R-I-D, Bootcamp. I don't know of any other program or course that is out there unless it's happened in the last couple of months. Okay, now let me talk to you about the brain of an alternative energy system. The inverter. Remember, well, I'll show you where the inverter sits, how it fits into a system. Inverters are rated by how much power they produce. And they're rated in watts. Our inverter is a 3,600 watt inverter. You can get 5,000 watt inverters. You can get 200 watt inverters. We got a 3,600 watt inverter. And that 3,600 watt inverter will do just about anything we need done for the two of us. Okay, inverters come either in sine wave or modified sine wave. Now I know you're wondering, what in the world is that? It's the type of electricity that the inverter makes. Let me show you. You have a graph here, and I don't know if you can, well, you can't tell it with this projector, but this line like this is in blue. And if you'll notice, it's a wave. It's not square and jagged like this red line, which is the symbol for the wave of a modified sine wave. This jagged one is modified sine wave, and this smooth one is sine wave. Now, I don't know how to explain all this, but the modified sine wave can do damage to your computers. They won't operate some refrigerator or some washing machines. They won't operate some paddle fans. They won't operate some copiers. If you get a sine wave inverter, it produces cleaner electricity than what you're seeing in here. Very clean, very smooth, very easy on your sensitive electronics. That's why every one of our DVDs were produced on a sine wave system. Nick produced them always on a sine wave system. I believe it was always. Okay, two of the best brands out there, should you become interested in either now or in the future, going off the grid. Outback Power Systems is one. That's the kind of system we have. We love it. We've had it about 8 or 9 years. Terrific. Outback Power Systems. They're out of the Seattle area. The other company is Magnum Power Systems. Nick has that system, and he loves it. Both of these are very good systems. Magnum branched off from Outback, so they all have the same good quality, I think, between them. Now, I've got to say this. I understand Outback has started outsourcing a lot of their equipment instead of being made here in the U.S. I don't know if that's good or not. Anyway. Okay, now let's look at an advanced alternative energy system. Yes, sir?
Question, the inverter converted DC to AC?
The inverters, the ones that I'm talking about are AC. Now, I'll explain why we've talked about AC and DC. I'm about to get into it. You have an inquiring mind a little ahead of me. A very basic system. You first start out with a generator. You've got to have a source of energy. And most generators are AC. That will send electricity to a charger. Now, why do we want to send it to a charger? Did you know every one of you probably have one of these? All you men? If you have a charger to charge your battery in your car, that's what we're talking about here. You plug that charger into an AC circuit, and then you grip the poles on your battery with alligator clips, and that's delivering DC electricity from AC in the wall. That's what this does. This charger takes the AC represented on our slides by red arrow and changes it to DC. so it can be stored in a battery. Then, you can turn your generator off once your battery bank is full and it's peacefully quiet. And anytime you turn on a light or whatever in your house, your inverter will get a signal saying, we need some electricity in the house. So DC comes up from the battery bank, it goes through the other side of that red box you see up here, and that's called an inverter. This whole box is called an inverter charger. And that takes the DC and changes it back to AC for your house. Does that make sense? That's about as simple as I can explain it. Now, whenever you want some peace and quiet, or you want to take advantage of the sun so you don't have to keep running that fossil fuel engine, you can get solar panels. Now, solar panels deliver electricity. They take power from the sun, and it is DC power, so it's connected directly to your batteries, but it has to go through a charge controller, which controls and senses when this battery bank is full. It will disconnect the battery bank from your solar panels so it will not overcharge. And you wonder, at least I did, I wondered, man, does the sun really put that much out? Will it even overcharge my batteries? And I tell you, one time I accidentally crossed the wires when I was hooking up just one solar panel, and that thing sparked like you wouldn't believe. It scared me, I almost dropped it. So the sun really puts out power like you wouldn't believe. Now, the other way that you can get supplemental energy without having to run the generator is through hydro generation. Hydro generation or a hydro generator produces electricity in the form of DC also. So it goes directly into the battery bank. Now, unfortunately, when you have your stream or creek or whatever running, you can't have a charge controller that will disconnect the hydro generator from your battery because this is full. It has to divert the load to something else to use up the electricity. If you were to disconnect the hydro generator, it would burn it up. So you have to divert it. The way you can divert it is have an element in your water heater, and it can help heat your water. It can run other things. But that's how that works. So, in your more advanced system, I'll just give you a little example of what we go through up in Idaho. Our winter months are very cloudy. Come November, October, November, we'll start getting cloudy days where our batteries start getting low and we need to charge it, either from the sun or from our generator. If the sun isn't shining, we turn the generator on and it supplements our battery. Then as December comes, our skies start getting cloudier or more cloudy. And so we'll run our generator more and more and rely less on our solar panels. And then come March, the sun starts coming out more and more and we start relying more on our solar panels and less on our generator. We don't have a hydro generator. Even though we have a creek, it would be too complicated to hook it up in our situation. So we decided to put up solar panels. Okay, now to finish this off, I want to go over two lists. The first list is what you can do when you are off the grid, when you have an alternative energy system. You can have lighting. I wired our house like a normal house, like I would in Macon. We have light switches and everything. I have a service panel and all of that. I wired 220 plugs behind the dryer in case we ever sell the house and somebody wants to go on the grid. The closest the grid is power lines, a mile and a quarter away. It's about 25,000 miles away. I mean, $25,000 away. But we plan for the future, always build with selling in mind. But you can have lights. We have LED lights. We went to Home Depot and we bought LED lights. I recommend these. You can have kitchen appliances. We have, we have a Vitamix mixer. Nancy just showed you how to make bread and she hand kneaded it. She didn't tell you she has a Bosch bread kneader at home that my dear sister and brother-in-law gave her. But it operates the Bosch bread kneader. We have a Champion juicer. You guys know what a Champion juicer is. We LG washer dryer. I have a Makita table saw, a Makita compound slider. I have a Makita, I have a Makita cordless drill that I charge it with. You can do anything, but you have to do it within reason. And it's well worth it. There's nothing like knowing you have your independent power system. Efficient refrigerator freezer. We have a SunFrost refrigerator. When we bought ours, it was more affordable. Now it's double the cost, but it's a DC refrigerator. Nancy is a really good cook, and she said, and she knows about kitchen appliances and everything. She said this SunFrost refrigerator is the best she has ever had. You can have a propane refrigerator. Hair dryers. We have one head of hair in our house. I can't speak for myself that way. Nancy's head of hair. If you have four or five women in your house, I don't know if I could say you could use a hair dryer. But if you use a hair dryer sparingly, it'll operate. The principle here is resistance heat. You want to keep the use of resistance heat to a minimum. Do y'all understand what I'm talking about when I say resistance heat, where electricity is used to heat metal or is used to cause certain elements to heat up and create heat? That's a no-no when you're off the grid. And a hairdryer uses resistance heat. Computers, you can use laptop computers off the grid. I might have said this, I'll tell you again. I think every one of those DVDs were produced with a laptop, very similar. It was quite a bit more powerful than this, but they were produced with a Mac laptop. You can use computers. Office equipment, we have a Canon copier, and when it's working, it works terrific. Now, I wouldn't run 500 copies off. We would go to Kinko's or wherever, Staples, wherever, but if we need 50 copies run off quickly, we can do that, no problem. Vacuum cleaner, if it's a good, efficient vacuum cleaner, yes, you can use it. Especially in the wintertime, when we're charging, our generator is so big, we have surplus electricity when it's charging, so we wash clothes, Nancy vacuums the floor. That's our day to use electricity while we're charging our battery. You need to time it that way, it really helps. Efficient water pumps, you can operate those off the grid. Ceiling fans, preferably DC ceiling fans. We live in a story and a half cabin, about 1,250 feet roughly, square feet. We absolutely love it. And because our loft is open, the heat has a tendency to collect up there. So we have a ceiling fan, a DC ceiling fan, that we run on slow speed 24/7 in the wintertime when we're heating with wood. It keeps that heat down in our cabin evenly heated. And that DC is DC, very efficient fan. It uses very little electricity. We can run it 24/7 and it hardly uses power. Washing machines, like I said, we have an LG washer. Front-loading washers are preferable. They use less water, they use less soap, use less electricity, I understand. Okay, and et cetera. Now, what you cannot do off the grid. First of all, you really shouldn't use major electric heating appliances. In other words, you shouldn't have a total electric house because you're going to have resistance heating and many other, you're going to have resistance hot water heater, electric water heaters, electric dryers. All of this stuff uses resistance heat. Electric water heater, electric heat, range and oven. Boy, that uses a lot of power, resistance power. Electric dryer uses a lot. A dishwasher does.
Toaster?
Yes.
Toaster?
A toaster, you know, you might on a sunny day, you could probably get by with using a toaster. And wintertime, you know, once you get, every system has a personality, and once you get used to it, you can tell whether you can use certain appliances or not. But yes, I think you can use a toaster, as long as you don't toast 50 slices of bread or whatever. But you know, just for a few people, you might be able to. Okay, inefficient large refrigerator freezer, especially the double wides. A regular refrigerator is an energy hog. Why? Because they cycle on and off 24/7. You need a very efficient refrigerator. I'm looking for the name. Energy, what is it, the name? Energy guard or whatever. You want it at the very least what is considered an energy guard or energy star, where they're very efficient. Or you can get a Sun Frost or a propane. We got a Sun Frost because we wanted to be as independent as possible, because the time is coming when you can't buy or sell. So what are you going to do when you can't buy propane? You can get the Sun for free, which runs our washing machine and runs our refrigerator. Okay, air conditioning. Do I not hear any groans? I tell people in other parts of the country, when I'm in the South that mention this, I hear groans. Well, down in middle Georgia and on further south, you hear them there because it's so humid. It's not as humid up here as down there. But the Japanese are putting out air conditioners that are so efficient. It's getting to where you can at least condition one room in your house. Now, you probably think, you know, I don't know if I want to live like that. But you've got to get your priorities straight. Where we live, we don't even need an air conditioner. I mean, it gets over 100 degrees during the summer. Sometimes, this year, the last several years, it hasn't. But in the evening, it cools down. It'll cool down in July and sometimes into the 40s. We just open our windows all night. When we wake up in the morning, we close our windows, and it stays very comfortable in our house until about 4 o'clock, maybe 5, and then you kind of sweat it out until the sun goes behind the mountains, and boy, the temperature drops in, and you open the windows. So we do fine. Now our son who lives, both of our children live in the area, our son who lives in the area, who lives off the grid, he just bought a nice Japanese air conditioner and it works great. They have two small children and it sure keeps peace in the house. So.
What would be the brand name? Are you talking about the wall unit or the whole house?
You know, I think I've heard Mitsubishi. And maybe Hitachi. I would go to Home Depot and see what they have. There are new systems that have just come out, and they're really efficient. They'll cool just one room, and I would just check and see. Or you can email Nick at Off Grid Bootcamp, and he can tell you more about it. He'll teach that in his class, those of you who are interested. Okay. I want to, yes, sir.
These can and can't do items are all dependent on the size of the system you install?
Yes, you're exactly right. Um, If you have a big system, a lot of solar panels, say like Congressman Bartlett does, you can do a lot of things, but it takes money. It takes thousands of dollars. We have 8 solar panels. Now, solar panels come in various wattage. We have around 1,400 watts of solar power. When you start looking into it, excuse me, you'll see, you'll understand what that means. Well, our solar array is a modest array, but for Nancy and I, it's great. So, okay, I want to show you, so you get an idea. Yes, sir. Yes, ma'am.
Wind power
is fine. The only problem is it's not consistent unless you live in the Columbia River Gorge and places like that.
Well, every time you go to the north, you drive up the north, there's a lot of wind power towers, sure. And they're always working. Some of them don't work, but some, at least like when you go over to Chicago, I'm from Chicago. Yeah. They're like the whole field full of windmills.
Yeah, they have a lot of those. They have a lot of those wind generator farms out west. Man, they'll have thousands of them sometimes when we're driving on seminar trips.
But
sometimes
air, they will work all the time.
Well, we see a lot of them that don't work. And also, those are huge. They're way up there. They look small, but when you see them being transported on a semi-trailer, they only take one blade at a time. They're so big. They have them up there where the current is. Most of us can't afford to get a wind generator up that far. I'm not big on wind generators, but if you want one, have at it. You can have it, and it'll supplement your system. And you might move to a place in the mountains where wind is consistently blowing through there, then by all means take advantage of that.
Go to the Windy City then. That's where wind is. Back to the Windy City.
Yeah. Let me, let's see, just a second here. This is that website I want to tell you about, offgridbootcamp.com. I'd like to show you two short promos, maybe 15 minutes total, to give you a little idea of what these DVDs are about. You can't buy these at Amazon.com. If you want to buy DVDs for entertainment, I don't recommend buying these. These are strictly instructional. You won't find DVDs like this anywhere that I know of. You've heard of Lehman's catalog? They wanted to buy our DVD about wood, getting started with wood cookstoves, because they sell a lot of wood cookstoves, and they wanted to buy our DVD, or at least handle it, and they were going to handle it through Stoves and More, because they have the rights to it also. And Daniel and Susan, who are advocates, they said, oh, Lehman said, but the only thing is you have to remove the religious statements off of it. And Daniel said, I'm sorry, that's part of my life. We can't do that. So Lehman's isn't carrying it now. But these DVDs are specifically for you folks. We talk to you for hours and probably wore you out. But these DVDs, there are days of DVDs out here with much more instruction than I could ever deliver. And we went to almost the four corners of the country to film experts, people who knew what they were talking about, most of them Seventh-day Adventists. And we produce these DVDs to help train you folks. Even though you might not be moving right now, you might in the future, you might not ever move. You might decide to get set up where you are if the Lord leads you to do that. So these DVDs are, I say, most important because they're highly instructional. And they come from experts from all over the country. Now our son Nick and our daughter-in-law Lisa are going to explain, so you get a little sample of what these DVDs are like. Hi, I'm Nick Meisner, and this is my wife, Lisa, and we have something really special that we want to share with you in this.
Okay, I need to do something here right quick, just a second. Uh-oh. I did something that I shouldn't have. Bear with me. As you can tell, I know precisely what I'm doing with the computer.
Hi, I'm Nick Meisner, and this is my wife, Lisa, and we have something really special that we want to share with you in this quick video.
You've likely heard of our Practical Skills DVD set that has helped literally thousands of folks across the world learn the practical nuts and bolts skills they need to become as independent as possible from the systems of the world. I'm particularly concerned about how utterly dependent almost everyone is on the system for their most basic necessities of life, such as water, heat, and food.
For years, we've been steadily producing more and more materials by various experts in an effort to shorten your learning curve and save you the time and money that's often lost from needless mistakes. Really, we just want to see you succeed. Time and again, we've seen what an incredible impact it makes to have access to the right training at the right time.
I don't know about you, but I'm tired of chasing down rabbit trails, wasting my time and money by trying out some harebrained theory dreamed up by an armchair expert and posted on YouTube. I just don't have time for that. I want solid information presented by an instructor with lots of real-world experience. I want to learn the methods that just plain work, and that's what the Practical Skills set is all about.
In the Fall Gardening Double DVD set, you'll learn the key building blocks for starting out your garden successfully. You'll learn why fall is the best time to start preparing your garden, and how to do it right, step by step, starting out with breaking up virgin ground all the way through to planting a fall crop. You'll see how to take a soil sample and add the right amendments for balancing that soil so that your food not only looks pretty, but so it's super packed with nutrition, which is much more important. Spring gardening picks up where fall gardening left off. The three DVDs in this set teach you how to wake up your garden in the spring, how to direct plant and transplant in the garden beds, caring for those young tender plants, scaling up to large field crops, step-by-step instructions on building a low-cost compost bed that really works, and a whole lot more are all covered in this set.
When it comes to having a secure food source, diversity is so important. If you lose certain crops from an infestation of pests or diseases or weather-related problems, being diversified can save the day, as problems that impact one crop may leave another one untouched. So large and small fruits are an essential addition to any vegetable garden. Our Fruit Culture DVD shows you how to handle small fruits like blueberries, strawberries, and grapes, in addition to larger fruits like apples. You'll learn how to save yourself a ton of money by grafting your own new fruit trees, how to prune fruit trees, how to propagate grapes, and much more.
And speaking of fruit trees, planting by the blueprint demonstrates a very unusual method of planting fruit trees that many have found to yield exceptional results. Fruit trees do take years to bear much fruit, and this unique method gives your new fruit trees the start they need to grow quickly and to grow strong. This is required watching before you plant your fruit trees.
There's only one totally independent and reliable source of heat, and that's wood heat. The most versatile way to heat with wood is using a modern Amish-made wood cook stove. With only one fire, you can not only heat your home, but also heat your hot water, cook and bake your food, all with that one fire. Our DVD, Getting Started with Wood Cook Stoves, shows you how to properly use and get the most out of your stove. It covers everything from choosing the right wood to the nuts and bolts of how to actually cook with the wood cook stove.
When living in a rural area, it's especially important to prevent a home fire, since it could take a while for the fire department to arrive. In our DVD, Dealing with Fire on the Homestead, a rural fire chief walks you through the important precautions you need to know about. In addition, anyone who heats with wood should be aware of several common sense rules that make a chimney fire all but obsolete. But what if the unthinkable happens, and you do have a fire? What do you do? Well, you'll learn straight from the fire chief's mouth what your best course of action is. Even wildland fires are covered in this important presentation.
All the other things we've mentioned are of little use if you are incapacitated from sickness. I believe we may see more and more superbugs in the days ahead, perhaps similar to the Spanish flu of 1918. And while there's a lot of attention given to the benefits of herbal remedies, there is another modality that is largely untapped and is incredibly helpful. In fact, as best as we can tell from historical records, it is one of the only treatments that was very successful in dealing with the 1918 Spanish flu. I'm talking about hydrotherapy, the use of water externally on the body, often using contrast of hot and cold. What could be simpler remedy than water? But we have found it to be incredibly effective when dealing with sickness. In fact, I think I'm safe in saying that while we certainly do use herbs, these little-known hydrotherapy treatments are our most used first-line option when dealing with many health-related concerns. You'll learn all about it in our DVD and book combo, The Lost Art of Natural Remedies, Hydrotherapy. The DVD demonstrates each step of each treatment so you can see it in action, while the book presents important details such as when to use a particular treatment and when to avoid it.
Tools for Country Living walks you through an experienced homesteader's tool room and demonstrates what to look for and what sort of useful tools that you might find at a yard sale for little to nothing. Most of these tools are low-tech, non-electric hand tools that are incredibly useful for any homestead.
Then, of course, there is water, perhaps the king of all necessities. While most folks realize that being on a municipal water system is not a good idea, they don't think about the fact that most folks living in the country have a well, and that well does them no good when the power is down. Think the electric pump. But while there are ways to set up a well independently, there's an often forgotten water source that used to be extremely common years ago, springs. Thanks to springs naturally pushing their water out of the ground without a pump, they can present some great options for water independence, such as a gravity flow system. But it all starts with a good spring, properly developed, protected from surface contamination, and channeled into a pipe. How do you do that? Our DVD, Springhead Development, demonstrates in real life how to do it using a time-tested method developed by a man who has many springheads under his belt.
What other options are there for independent water systems? That's just one of the many topics that are covered in our book, Sustainable Preparedness. In addition to covering water systems, this thorough but concise book teaches you about off-grid power systems, heating with wood, food preservation, what to look for at land or a homestead, and a lot more.
While it's an important necessity to learn the nuts and bolts of homesteading, sometimes it really helps to just take a tour of homesteads where folks are actually implementing various aspects of this lifestyle. That's exactly what you'll find in our epic DVD, Urban Danger. Not only will you get to tour a wide variety of homesteads and see how they do things, you'll find it to be quite inspirational to see the impact this lifestyle has had on their lives. The This is also a great DVD for sharing with folks you care about and would like to consider making a transition in this direction.
This 13 DVD and 2-book package is probably our most popular product since it has all the goods at a huge discount. Our next most popular product is a DVD set that I consider to be required for anyone who's serious about food independence. It all started several years ago when we decided to put our money where our mouth was and take a 5-day intensive hands-on gardening course by Bob Gregory, a man that I consider to be one of the foremost experts on all things gardening. It cost $500 a person at that time. I think it's over $600 now. And I can tell you that it was worth every penny. But I realized that not everyone can take a week off of work, travel to West Virginia, and pay $600 for a gardening course. So I talked with Bob, and we decided to record his training course and put it on DVD for the benefit of those who couldn't attend in person. It's called Food Growers Guidelines, and it turned into a 9+ hour, 6-DVD course that is absolutely packed with the training you need to take your garden to the next level. A hobby garden is not good enough. We all need a garden that reliably produces lots of nutritious food. And that's what Bob teaches you in this incredible set, coming from a scientific approach, as opposed to what I see so many folks do. So not only do you learn about soil science, but you'll learn the best approaches for dealing with pests, such as how to use the disease triangle to your advantage, and avoid costly and damaging sprays whenever possible. Seriously, I cannot recommend this course enough.
Brand new Preserving the Harvest 4-DVD set. This thorough yet concise set visually demonstrates the various ways to preserve your food for use during the winter. You'll learn all about canning with an actual demonstration of both water bath and pressure canning. It's not scary, and in fact, it can be a lot of fun if you know what you're doing.
You'll learn how to properly dehydrate food and preserve the maximum nutrient content. And while you'll get to see different electric dehydrators in action, we'll also tell you about a cheap solar dehydrator that we made.
Some foods just work better frozen, and we'll walk you through the process of doing it properly. We'll also go through how to prepare food for being frozen.
Vacuum sealing is a great way to extend the useful life of your refrigerated, frozen, and non-perishable food items. But there are some important cautions that you need to be aware of. You'll learn all about it, and you'll even discover a trick that I found where I can get equipment needed to vacuum seal jars for only $30.
Culturing is one of the oldest forms of food preservation known to man and has been largely forgotten. You'll learn how simple and effective it is with real-life demos of making sauerkraut, cultured vegetables, and even yogurt.
Grains like wheat can store very well for many years if stored properly, but if you don't follow the right techniques that we show you, I've seen wheat be unfit for use in a year or less. We'll show you how to avoid that.
Root cellars are nature's refrigerator and can actually keep food in good condition for longer than a refrigerator if properly set up. You'll learn the important factors you need to know about and get a tour of several working root cellars for ideas of how others have done it.
Some produce, like garlic and onions, needs to be cured properly in order to be usable and last for months. It's very simple, and we'll show you how it's done.
Finally, have you ever wanted to learn how to make really delicious bread and never could get it to turn out right? Well, we've got you covered. While bread making is not a food preservation skill, it is a food-related skill that many folks would like to learn. And after many requests, we are including it in this awesome set.
In addition to all that, you'll learn how to plan your food needs out and actually come up with a fairly accurate estimate of what food, how much food your family actually uses and needs. The method we teach in these videos will make sure that the food you store never gets too old and that you don't end up with a bunch of disgusting food stashed away in your basement waiting until it goes bad. This is for a working pantry and a homestead that is perpetually prepared, not a doomsday bunker.
I'm sorry.
Is that your woods?
That's where Nick and Lisa live.
Yeah.
Want to thank you for coming today. I hope you
learned a little bit. I'm sure you're probably tired, but this is why we produce these DVDs, so you can spread this out over many, many weeks. May God bless you and all you do. Don't be discouraged if you listen to this and say, how can I do this? I don't have any money. Let me tell you, we run into people all the time saying that. The Lord provides. You just don't know yet how He will provide. We can tell you stories, I mean hours and days, but don't get discouraged. The Lord loves you. He will make a way for you. After all, He's told us to get out of the cities, out of the cities, out of the cities. Now, why would He tell us to do something if we can't do it, if He won't help us? Thank you for coming. Let's have a word of prayer before we leave. Heavenly Father, thank you for every precious soul that was here today, because they are the ones that were here today are the ones that I believe would have gotten on the ark. And Father, we're facing another flood now, not just South Florida or Houston. We're facing a humongous flood of what's coming. And dear Lord, you've shown us a way to sail on through. It might be rocky, might be scary, but dear Lord, what comes after that, we know is beyond imagination. So I pray that you'll bless and guide everyone that has come today, and bless them. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you for coming.